right now. What is this? Make me wanna run on anyhow. Whatever it is, oh, I just can't hold my peace.
Magnificent and wonderful name of our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. In him we live, move, and have our being. I am delighted and excited about the month of May. The month of May. We're in the month of May. Praise the Lord for the month of May. God is moving. He is doing great and marvelous things. He is getting this pandemic under control, and he is blessing his children. So on today, I just wanted to share with you some ideas and some thoughts that we should have as being in the body of Christ. Turn with me to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 16 through 18. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 16 through 18. It says that you should rejoice always, pray without ceasing, and in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Let us pray. Eternal God, we thank you for this moment. We thank you for this time. God, we thank you for who you are and all that you do in the lives of your children. Now, God, it is preaching time. Therefore, we ask you to allow me to preach until the real preacher comes, the precious anointing of the Holy Spirit. Therefore, God, if I stand with any arrogance, God, humble me. But if thou find any fear in me, God, strengthen me. Remove me from me and use me for thee. We ask it all in the powerful and perfect name of Jesus the Christ, our kinsman redeemer. I want to share some characteristics of a Christian. I was sharing with my congregation about how our name have been changed. The Bible says, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things are passed away, and behold, all things are now new. So there ought to be some changes and some characteristics about you as being a child of God. I'm not talking about you being a Taurus or a Capricorn or Scorpio. I'm talking about you being a Christian, someone who is a child of God. So I want you to understand that today, that your worship, that what you give unto God is out of your experience. What do you mean, preacher? I was watching a TV show a little while back. I'm sure many of you who are smokers understand what I'm talking about. It was about this Nicoderm patch, and it's to help people to quit smoking. And by the end of the commercial, it says, for every great why, there is a great how. So my question is to you, why did you come to church when you went to church? Why did you get up early every week? You came to the same place. You sat in the same pew, next to the same people, listened to the same preacher every week. Why? Because your worship was born of your experience. The Bible says tribulation worketh patience. Patience worketh experience, and experience hope. That hope does not make us ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad. The only way to properly worship, truly worship, is out of what you have been through. You can't tell nobody else's testimony. You can only give yours. You can only talk about what you have been through. It must be born out of your life experience. So when God has been real good to you, when God has really brought you out, your worship is for real. I wish I can get a witness up in here today. It is not repetitious. It is not routine. But your worship is for real. It takes on a different flavor in your life, because now you know why you do what you do. And you get excited about who he is. I know why, because I worship. But Paul teaches us, not only do we worship, but we need to know why we worship. He says, Paul, rejoice evermore. Always be rejoicing. Always be excited. Always be enthusiastic. Always be full of joy. Pray continually without ceasing. And in everything, not for everything, but in everything. See, I'm not grateful for cancer that's been in my family's life, but I'm grateful for the situation that God has brought them through. I'm not grateful for the headaches that I have to go through, but I'm thankful in the midst of my situation. Because I know trouble don't last always. I'm not grateful for the storm, but I praise God even while in the midst of the storm. So in this group of three exhortation, Paul leaves the habits that characterize the Christian relationship to God. And the first one that I think you ought to understand as a characteristic is praise. Look at verse 16. It leads us to praise. Rejoice evermore. Paul says, never encourages us to deny that adversity may bring us some sadness and some grief. Because why? Romans 12 and 15 tells us to rejoice with those who rejoice, but to weep with those who weep. But to recognize that in the midst of the most agonizing situation, the presence of God through his Spirit can infuse a soul with hope and a heart with joy. Joy, not just being happy, but I'm talking about joy. See, happiness is contingent on what is happening in your life. But joy is in spite of what is happening in your life. Have you ever noticed how some people, they don't even smile? They don't get excited about living? So see, everybody does not have the same personality. Some people just wake up happy. It is their personality. Others seem cold, but I found out that life has a way of tempering you. Okay, let me see if I can help you out. I don't confess to be a great baker, but I do watch people who can cook. And they got this thing called the Food Network. And when you watch them and they preparing a mixture that requires eggs, and the mixture is warm, and then the eggs have to be put in real slow, to temper the mixture, or that it'll scramble the eggs. You will mess up and end up in, putting it in too quickly. See, somebody here, I'm trying you to understand. So you got to pour a little bit in at a time to get it acclimated to the temperature. Well, that is how God deals with us as his children when it refers to our joy. God mixes enough trouble with enough happiness to fill us with contentment and joy. Because we are not always jumping up and down. Come on, y'all. Because we are not always excited about what is going on in life. Because we understand that you can be up today and down tomorrow. We understand that trouble could be right around the corner that you're not even expecting it, but it can happen. But it comes out of faith that has been tempered, that you believe that everything is going to be all right. Our joy has complete because we are not always happy, but we should always be full of joy. See, happiness comes and goes, but joy should always remain. What you mean, preacher? Joy keeps you coming to church when the things are falling apart in your life. Joy keeps your head up even when you're sad. Joy makes you say hallelujah even when you don't understand why. It doesn't matter who's sitting next to you. If God has been good to you, your joy springs up in your life. See, the believers in that day was not to display the dispassionate indifferences of the Stoic, nor grasp the impersonal naturalism of the Neoplatonics, nor hold the narrow academic approach of the life of the skeptics. They could not fall prey to the rigorous idealism of the cynic, nor eat, drink, or marry philosophy of the Epicurean. The church was unique in its proclamation that joy was at the heart of its faith. So if you do not have real lasting joy, it was a serious questioning of your commitment to the Lord Jesus Christ. Why? Because nobody can come to Jesus, be saved, and leave the same way they came. I need to say that again. Nobody can come to Jesus, be saved, and leave the same way that you came. There's something about that name. There's something wonderful about his name. And just Sunday morning ought to get you excited. Oh, folk that were raised in the country can testify to this. The folk in the country, they got ready for church on Saturday. Back in the day, they would get up and clean the house on Saturday. They would start dinner on Saturday for Sunday, pull out their church clothes, get ready for church. Now, don't get me wrong. They still went out and had a good time and danced on Saturday night, but they knew Sunday was coming. They knew that Sunday was the Lord's day, and they knew that they were going to spend all day in church. Now, folk don't want to stay in church 2 hours now because they say church holds too long. And I believe even when they open the church back up, many folk ain't want to come because they're going to get used to what we're doing now with this virtual service. But when you come to church, you have to give God your best praise. When you worship God in the video, you ought to give God your best praise. You should be tired when you get done praising God. Look, when I get done praising God, when I lead a worship service, I want to be tired to where I need a nap before I can even drive home. Why? Because God deserves my best hallelujah. I'm leaving it all on the field for God. This may be my last time, so I'm going to praise his holy name. I woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. Old folks say, I'm walking and talking with my mind stayed on. I'm singing and praying with my mind stayed on the Lord. I did not come to church to spectate, but I come to church to participate. I give God my best smile. I give God my best shot. I lift up my hands and I praise his name. Rejoice evermore. Secondly, verse 17 tells us to pray without ceasing. And prayer and praise go along together. That should be some prayer in your life. Pray continually. Praise continually. I'm coming back to that in just a minute. Prayer was not to be limited to prescribed hours, but should be rather a common, consistent element in our daily lives. Here's what praise and prayer without ceasing should mean. It does not mean you walk around every day going, oh, hallelujah, praise the Lord, like you crazy, or you somebody done lost their mind. No, that is not what it means. It means like the picture of a person who has an intermittent cough. See, pollen is real hard in our area here in Virginia. So when you get pollen in your throat, you feel like something right in the back of your throat, and like you like a tickle in your throat, and every now and then you just want to cough to get it out. So a cough is possible. You're not coughing all day, but a cough could come up at any minute in your life. You're not praying all day, but when you need it, it's right there in the back of your throat. You're not praising all day, but when you need it, it's right there in the back of your throat. A praise just jumps up right away. A prayer can just jump up. Right, it's right in the back of your throat. Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. It's always in the back of your throat. And people don't know why. People don't even understand why you act the way you act. Folks start talking about the goodness of the Lord. And yeah, you just got to say, thank you. It doesn't matter if you're on your job. It doesn't matter if you're in the kitchen cooking your food. It doesn't matter if you're cleaning your house. It's just about when you hear the goodness of Jesus and all he's done for you. You just want to clear your throat and say, thank you, God. Likewise, prayer and praise is like that intermittent cough in the back of your throat. There are some things that are some cough suppressants in your life. Y'all might as well say it's rough in here. Yes, I am. Can I give you some cough suppressants? Pride is a cough suppressant. Hatred is a cough suppressant. Judgmental spirits are cough suppressants. Envy is cough suppressant. Anger is a cough suppressant. God wants a praise out of you, but he has to get some of that other stuff out of you before he can get a praise out of you. Is there anybody here that knows that your praise has been perfected because of what you've been through? Can I get a witness in here whose praise has been perfected by the storms you've had to go through? That your praise has been perfected by the mess that you found yourself in? And can I be honest with you? I'm looking for the real praises. I'm looking for folk who say, look, I got myself in the mess, Pastor, but I praise God anyway, even when I messed up, because I heard if you confess your sin, he is faithful and just to forgive me of that sin and cleanse me of all my unrighteousness. So even while I got myself in the middle of some stuff, I learned to give God some praise, and I learned to say, thank you for being a good father. Thank you for being a merciful father. Thank you for being a forgiving father. Every now and then, you need to rewind in your mind, your track of time in your life, and you'll begin to tell God, thank you. Hallelujah, somebody. I tell them, looking for the real folk in here today. They're praising God because of all the stuff that you know you've been through, and God has brought you out. You're praying and praising God because of everything in your life hasn't always been good, but you recognize that any minute God can turn that thing around and a praise begin to come up. Listen, if it was real, it can happen in your car. When your praise is real, it can happen at dinner, in your house, all by yourself. You don't need an audience. It doesn't even have to be on Sunday morning. You just begin to look back and open up your closet and you see how good the Lord has been to you. Excuse me now. I had a rewind in my mind. Thank you, Jesus, for watching over me when I didn't know how to watch over myself. Thank you, Jesus, for forgiving me when you could have struck me down. I'm so glad I got a God that when I begin to pray, I praise is coming next, because I pray and then I praise and then I praise and then I gotta do a little prayer and then I pray and then I praise. Ain't it all right? Is there anybody here that feels like I do? You feel like just telling God thank you? Why don't you take a few moments and just begin to thank God? Thank God for what he's done for you, what he's brought you through, what he's carrying you through right now. Finally, verse 18 says, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Thankfulness is the opposite of complaining. I could complain, but I won't. I used to complain, but I won't no more. I might need to complain, but I won't, because when I put my blessings, beside my complaints, I'm about to run and lose my mind up in here. When I put my blessings next to my complaints, the balance of the scale always is tilted toward my blessings, because my blessings far outweigh my complaints. What do you mean, preacher? You remember the Israelites, don't you? They had more reason to be thankful than any other people in the Bible, yet they were guilty of doing the most complaining like no other nation in Scripture. They watched God move on their behalf. I'm not talking about what they heard, not the second generation, but those that's in the promised land, but I'm talking about the generation that God brought out out of Egypt. If anybody should have been praising God, it should have been that crowd right there. Why? Because they saw God work miracles in their life. They saw God open up a Red Sea, and they saw God let them walk on through on dry ground. And then the enemies were tracking after them. They saw the same God that opened up the Red Sea, let the enemies get in the middle of it and close it down upon them. Well, Miriam, Moses' sister, she got a tambourine out, y'all, and she began to sing a song. My God is a man of war. He has fought many battles and has never lost one. And Jehovah is his name. I say they saw that, y'all, and they were hungry. God rained down food called manna, bread from heaven. They saw that. They kept on complaining. They said they got bread, but we ain't got no meat to eat. And God said, I'm going to make an east wind blow through. And God gave them some quails. You wonder why we love chicken. God brought some chicken in their life. And they began to eat the chicken, eat the quail. And they complain about that. We got bread and we got meat, but we ain't got nothing to wash it down with, Moses. And God told Moses, go and speak to the rock and watch sweet water flow from that rock. I say they got a chance to see it. Not only that, their sandals did not wear out. They wore the same clothes for 40 years. So if anybody should have been giving God some praise, it should have been the children of Israel. Well, let's not be too hard on Israel, because they got some kinfolk that I'm talking to right now. That's some African Americans. If anybody should be praising God, it ought to be people of color. Why? You saw Bull Connor. You saw dogs that they sit on our children. You saw fire hoses. You had to go through the back door. You dealt with Jim Crow segregation. You were called a schoon, a spook, a gal, a uncle, a boy, and a nigger. Yeah, I said it. You saw them dehumanize your people. But through it all, God has brought us through. And now we act like we can't give God no praise. So you wonder why I holler the way I holler. You wonder why I make the noise the way I make noise. Because I'm grateful for what my family went through. I'm grateful for what my older siblings had to go through. I'm grateful for what my mom and daddy go through. Not because they went through it. I'm grateful because God brought them out. He brought me from a mighty long way. He made a way out of no way. He did some things for me that I couldn't do for myself. So every time I get a chance, I will rejoice over his goodness. I'll shout over his blessing. Is there anybody here who can help me testify right where you are and tell God he's good? God is merciful. God is faithful, and he's worthy. He's worthy to be praised. So if you don't want to praise him, I'll praise him all by myself. If I'm the only one that's in my family, I'm going to praise him. If I'm the only one when I get back to church on my pew, I'm going to praise him. If I'm the only one that's in my section, I'm going to praise him. I'll lift up my voice because I'm going to rejoice because God has been good to me. See, I don't know when trouble is coming next, but if I learn to praise him, even when trouble come, I'll praise him in my trouble. I'll praise him in my sickness. I don't know when hardship gonna come, but I'll praise him even in my hardship. Why? Because it's right there in the back of my throat. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. You've been a mother for me. I want to thank you. You've been a father for me. I want to thank you. You've been a sister. I want to thank you. You've been my brother. I want to thank you. Is there anybody here that know that God is a keeper? If the Lord made a way for you, why don't you clear your throat and give God some praise? If the Lord made a way out of no way, why don't
don't you help me magnify his name? If the Lord opened doors for you, why don't you give him glory? Why? Because I've seen the lightning flashing. I've heard the thunder roar. I felt sin breakers dashing. They were trying to conquer my soul. But I heard the voice of Jesus bidding me still to fight on. Church, he promised never to leave me, never to leave me alone. So when hard times, I'm going to give God some glory. When trouble comes, I'm going to praise his name, because this is the will of Christ Jesus within you. Thank you, Jesus. I got some good sleep last night. Thank you, Jesus. I had somewhere to lay my head. Thank you, Jesus. I got family and friends. Thank you, Jesus. I'll rejoice evermore. I'll pray without ceasing. And in everything, I'm going to give thanks. Because he's a rock in a weary land. He's a shelter in a time of storm. He's a friend, y'all, to the friendless. Bread when I'm hungry. Water when I'm thirsty. He's everything I need and more. There ought to be some characteristics. If you call yourself a Christian, you ought to be able to praise, pray, and rejoice evermore. Be thankful for what he's done, what he's doing, and what he is yet going to do. May God bless you. May God keep you. I pray that if someone is not saved, does not know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you would take a moment right now and let him enter into your spirit, enter into who you are, and say, Lord, I'm a sinner. I need to be saved. And if you believe that he is the Son of the living God, and that he died and was raised on the third day for everlasting life, you shall be saved. I pray that you would pray that prayer, that God will save you from the guttermost to the uttermost. May God bless you, my friends. Have mercy upon you, and let his countenance continue to shine upon you and give you peace. Until we meet again, God bless you. God bless you.
This song is for those that know without a doubt in their mind. God has rescued you from something. Don't tell your business, but look at somebody and tell them, I made it out all right.
watching.